Her health is frail, and she requires assistance to walk, but that's only slowed Ruth Asawa. This spring day, she has come out to the De Young Museum in San Francisco's Golden Gate Park to witness evolution in the making. The museum is being demolished to make way for its new incarnation, one featuring a tower dedicated to education.
It's programmed to have all the museum's services for teachers, services for kids, classrooms. The resource centers are all in the tower. A lot of it is due to this lady. Ruth was really the first person to embrace the tower concept when the architects started to come up with a very unusual design. And I think she persuaded a lot of people to love the tower.
We got the students involved by making a bank, and we gave each public school a bank to fill up, and we gathered a few thousand dollars, even if it was 10 cents or 5 cents. We involved the students, and they went around, and I know that in the halls, they persuaded the children to be involved in the tower.
Involvement with art in the schools is a rallying cry for Ruth. Her influence is apparent at Alvarado Elementary School in San Francisco, where her children and now grandchildren attend. As a young mother, she became involved here early on. Concerned about budget cutbacks and its impact on children and the arts, she began a foundation and co-founded the Alvarado School Art Workshop. The results are visually stunning. But this activism isn't limited to children. The community garden at Fort Mason is a living testament to Ruth Asawa's dedication to inclusivity and creating all kinds of art. When she helped found the San Francisco Art Commission in the early 1970s, one of its priorities was to set aside open space for a public community garden. It has become an opportunity for a different kind of artist to showcase his or her work, and is consistent with Ruth's desire to involve people to share knowledge with others. The whimsical San Francisco fountain at the Grand Hyatt on Union Square is an example.
I didn't know where the Hyatt fountain would take me. So I got a Union 76 map and I spotted places around the city, and even we put the landmarks down, up, and around. And then I said, you could put the trees in. So I made my mother make trees. And you're good at making the cars, so I'll put you in charge of the cars, and you can see them around the fountain. We need a car now, so that person made a car. We're in the park now, so we need bicycles. So we put the bicycle people in there, and we went just around logically, around the city. And we said, Willie Mays came in and made a home run. So we put him by Kansas State Park. We put it down at the bottom of it. The thing that was so interesting that everybody has a different hand, so it doesn't look like it's made by one hand. It's made by many hands, and so it has that look of not being a trademark that I made, but of everybody. And some people are better, some people are not as good. And so you get all that in there. And I felt that was very good too. And that's how I taught. That's how I teach. And so I think that's how we learn. And the thing is, all I had to say to them was, do your very best, and I get the best out of them at that time.
The home that Ruth and husband Albert Lanier have crafted together is an incubator for creativity and learning, which may explain why two of their six children are artists, with a new generation of Asawa Laniers ready to follow in those footsteps. Their artistic roots go back to Black Mountain College in North Carolina, where Albert, an architect student, met Ruth. It was an exciting time in their lives, creating and experimenting with the likes of John Cage, Merce Cunningham, Buckminster Fuller, and teachers such as Joseph Albers.
I learned technique in Mexico of making a basket, and they were making baskets. And a student at Black Mountain said, well, why don't you go up with it? So I enclosed it and I went up with it. Who knows what they were at the time? You know, they were an onion, they were a this, and you can see in nature that it's a form. And then you can see that an insect's wings, you can see the transparency of it. And that's one of the things that Albers taught us, was to get an opaque color. And that opaque color is getting two colors together. And in real life, it doesn't make a transparency, but you have to form a transparency out of an opaque color. That is very appealing to a student who is studying. The technique is very simple. It's just that you're a person of patience, and you can't teach that very easily. It's like crocheting. You go around like this, and you keep increasing. You increase a little bit and catch it the next time. You increase it, and equally, you make it every fifth one. You 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you make a loop in there. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you make a loop in there. And then you go like, and you pick it up, and it gets big like this, just like crocheting. You're doing crocheting.
Ruth's modesty and humility belie the critical acclaim she's received in the art world. Her work has been exhibited in major museums around the world, and she's considered one of the premier artists in her field. Her art inspires awe, creativity, and joy. But it is the Japanese American Memorial in San Jose that is her most personal work. It depicts the Japanese American experience, from the struggles of being an immigrant to the loss of liberty because of incarceration during World War II.
But if you look at all the scenes, they are scenes of people remember being there and doing this, and they remember it. It's a hardship, but it's also an experience that they want to remember too. And so that's the kind of thing I want to show at San Jose, was a thing that they are proud of, and also they are sad that it ever happened, that it shouldn't have happened. But if I hadn't witnessed it myself, then I couldn't have done it either. So all I did was, rather than write a biography of myself, I made a biography of my life in that San Jose Memorial Monument, because it was the hardship of my early childhood, and the internment was much easier for me because I had a hard life before.
In the golden glow of her sunset years, it's the children that Ruth thinks about most nowadays. She has done much on their behalf, whether it's fundraising and campaigning for the new museum tower, or finding ways to make sure that art will always be a part of their lives.